Let's continue. Chapter 17 opens with a funny conversation between master and squire, during which Sancho loses his patience with Don Quixote and then has to disguise the meaning of his own words so as not to insult him. We will see this wonderful technique repeated throughout the novel. But there is seriousness here as well. For example, the novel's north-south trajectory appears again in the narrator's reference to a famous ballad of the Cid. This is developed further when Don Quixote concludes that the beating he has just received was because the treasured beauteousness of this damsel must be guarded by some enchanted Moor and must not be intended for me. Sancho agrees, adding that more than 400 Moors have beaten me. Don Quixote replies that everything will be all right. I will now prepare the precious balm with which we will heal ourselves in the blink of an eye. When the lawman returns with a lamp, we have another vignette of human cruelty. The officer asks Don Quixote casually, "How are you, good fellow?" Don Quixote objects to the officer's informality, saying, "Is it customary in this land to speak like that to knights errant, you idiot?" The officer then whacks Don Quixote in the head with the lamp, and everyone is in the dark again. Sancho now produces an ironic comment. "Certainly, sir, that is the enchanted Moor, and surely he keeps the treasure for others, and for us only produces fists and candle blows." If wrath and anger are the main problems in this fortress, Don Quixote has the remedy at hand. "Ask them to give me a little oil, wine, salt, and rosemary in order to make the therapeutic balm. In truth, I think I have great need for it now because I am losing much blood from the wound that phantom gave me." This hint at the metaphysical topic of ghosts will be explored in greater detail in coming chapters. But back to the carnivalesque world of Don Quixote and his balm. Note how, when Sancho asks the officer for its ingredients, he insults the squire, this time intentionally, by passing along to the innkeeper what that good fellow wanted. Don Quixote mixes his basic elements into a compound of them, and now we have another of the novel's irreverent mockeries of Catholic ritual, as our Hidalgo says 80 paternosters over the flask and as many Hail Marys, Salve Reginas, and Apostles' Creeds. And each word was accompanied by the blessing sign of a cross. If you can read what happens now without laughing, perhaps you should rethink the idea of Don Quixote practicing medicine. As soon as he finished drinking it, he began vomiting, such that he left nothing in his stomach. Nevertheless, 3 hours later, Don Quixote feels completely cured, and the narrator reports that with that remedy, he could undertake henceforth with no fear whatsoever, any fight, battle, or challenge, no matter how dangerous it might be. When Sancho sees this, he takes it as a miracle and wants to try the balm himself. Here, Cervantes' narrative voice is impressive. It appears to be the case, however, that poor Sancho's stomach was not as delicate as that of his master, and so before he vomited, he felt so ill and such nausea and endured so much sweating and fainting that he thought it was truly his final hour. And finding himself in such agony and distress, he cursed both the balm and the thief that had given it to him. Don Quixote's reaction is also laughable. "I believe, Sancho, that you are so afflicted because you have not been dubbed a knight." And the final result is even worse. At this point, the potion took effect, and the poor squire overflowed by way of both channels, and with such force that neither the reed mat on which he lay nor the burlap blanket with which he covered himself could ever be used again. He perspired and dripped with such paroxysms and calamities that not only he, but everyone there thought his life was surely over. But let's not laugh for a minute. If we adopt the innkeeper's perspective, what happens now is not at all funny. First, as he leaves, Don Quixote steals a pike in a corner of the inn, behaving very much like the thief that Sancho has just cursed. Then, all the time making eyes at the daughter of the innkeeper, the Hidalgo asks if he can repay his host by ensuring that he is avenged of some arrogant villain who hath offended thee. The landlord responds with calm and precision, "All I want is that you pay me for the night you spent in my inn, for the straw and barley given to your two beasts, and for your dinner and your beds." Oh, Jesus. Again, hath Don Quixote learned nothing by his previous outing? And who pays in the end? The squire, of course. The episode ends with the famous and unforgettable blanketing of Sancho Panza. A group of rascals, pícaros, who also frequent a certain market in Seville, the south again, take revenge on Sancho, as if inspired and moved by a common spirit. It's another hilarious scene, but we've already laughed a lot. So let's finish chapter 17 by noting how Cervantes indicates a moral that is both Christian and bourgeois. After being tossed in a blanket, when Sancho requests that Maritornes bring him wine instead of water, the narrator informs us that she did so out of very good will, and she paid for it with her own money, because in fact, it can be said of her that, although she was of the profession, she still had certain signs and shades of a Christian woman. And here Cervantes' carnivalesque reveals an important detail about Sancho's departure. The landlord kept his saddlebags in payment for what was owed. And one last insult for Don Quixote. The landlord wants to lock the door because he fears the Hidalgo might return, but according to the narrator, the blanketeers would not agree to it, for they deemed him not worth two farthings of worry.